this is going to be awkward. As you can tell, we're nurses, so if you're expecting a slick, well-presented presentation, this is where it all goes hideously wrong. The NHS has arrived. So, bit of introduction from me. I'm the Chief Nurse Information Officer for Worcester Acute. What do I get up to? I'm also the chair of the Digital Discussion Group. I'm on the Digital Health CNIO Advisory Panel. Just finished the Digital Academy. So I've been around. Nursing, probably just getting up for qualified for about 30 years now. I know, I just look so young. I've worked everywhere. I've worked in ITUs, recoveries, theatres, anaesthetics, on the wards, every grade under the sun up to matron level, and then started dabbling in a bit of QI and ended up in the CNIO role. Because reality, what is digital transformation apart from QI? Oh, I have to press a button now.
So you'll see I haven't got a giraffe. I wanted a polar bear, but he couldn't find me one. I'm not really sure why. So that's me. I'm both the regional CNIO and at the CNIO for Sherwood Forest. For those of you that don't know, that's a tiny, weeny trust in North Nottinghamshire. You will hear that I've got no voice. I'm very poorly. Similar to Matt, really, I've been a registered nurse for 30-something years and done very similar stuff, so gone up and down and round and round bands and grades, fell into quality improvement and programme management, and then during COVID thought, might fancy a bit of nursing again, and this role came up and absolutely suited my skill set, really.
Multitasking, pressing buttons and more buttons. So, why are we here? Let's talk about the role of the CNIO, because we're amazing. And reality, 2 years ago, there weren't that many dedicated CNIOs. There were CCIOs with nurses that were doing it, there were a few APs dabbled, but the last 2 years, the NHS has really woken up to the fact that actually, having somebody who knows something about digital, has a clinical background, might make the digital programs go a little bit easier. So, where am I? Basically, Rewired last year, Ruth May stood up in front of Digital Health Rewired and said, I'd like a CNIO in every organisation. And since then, it pretty much, everybody's woken up to the fact that actually, it might be a sensible thing to have. So, what do I do? So, a CNIO is a senior nurse in the organisation. Basically, I bridge the gap between those IT people that work on the floor that are incredibly clever, the clinical people that think they're technically clever, but actually, as soon as you put something in front of them, they look very panicked and figure out what's going on. You know, us clinicians, we're very, very good at wanting shiny toys. But having the CNIO in there, you know, we need to make sure it works right for our patients. And we're there to sort of bring the two together. So, specifically, you know, I lead the digital clinical transformation throughout the trust. I'm the lead for the design and delivery of the digital systems. I'm responsible for QI and benefits in the digital world. I'm also accountable for the clinical risk. So if it all goes wrong, it's also my fault. But, you know, as much as we're looking at the digital systems, we are very much looking at a clinician's point of view. How is it going to work for the guys on the floor? Now, my lovely colourful slide basically was just to point out that, you know, it's not just about EPRs. Because everybody thinks hospitals, EPRs, that's all about. In my trust, at any given time, we've got 150 concurrent digital projects going on about transformation. And I'm in and out of a large proportion of them. Some of them just happen in the background. You know, I don't really need to get involved in a nice new software for setting up COVID swabbing, but there's an awful lot that does need the clinical input to make sure it works.
So I pretty much do what Matt does in my acute trust, and I can only echo that sort of translation. And I talk a lot about how we think people work to how they actually work. And a lot of value that I bring is helping my IT colleagues to understand how a product is going to be used in the real world, and that's very different. And I also spend a lot of time telling people that clinicians that I know they want Fortnite, but they've got, you know, Pong at best, and they think that what they have at home they can have replicated at work. So we have lots of discussions, and lots of people say, I don't know what Pong is. Well, Google it. As the regional CNIO, and I can't read that down there, I do all of those things that quite wordy, isn't it? So support clinical leadership of digital transformation. So I basically work for Natasha Phillips's team, and there's seven of us in the region that come together and deliver her priorities. And then I work with people like Matt, previously Karina, I've brought my fan club, and Kerry, although having said that, they've both left the Midlands region since I've come. And we make sure that the regional nursing voice is heard in those national priorities. So a bit of a strap line. The national team is that we need to ensure that things are locally delivered. And that's where I think the ICS is definitely come into play, that local delivery. You may click.
Oh, looks like I'm talking again. Sorry. So, why do we need nurses in digital? And we do need doctors, we need healthcare assistants as well, and we need AHPs. But I'm a nurse, so I'm going to talk about it for why do we need nurses in digital. You know, reality, the IPSOS Morris thing, we're the most trusted profession. We're amazing. So why wouldn't you want a nurse in amongst it? You know, we've proven time and time again that consistently we can adapt and develop in response to what our patients need. And the key thing is we actually spend more time with the patient than any other professional. So if you're designing a system to work and support clinical care, get the users involved. Because you may actually get a system that people adopt and actually want to use, rather than a system that's clunky and we end up adapting and fiddling and trying to change. You know, so why are nurses so particularly invested in digital? Well, you can tell which posh papers I read, The Times, Independent. I can't put the Daily Star up there, okay? But the newspapers are constantly talking about the paperwork, the endless, endless paperwork that nurses complete and doctors. This is not what it's all about for us. It's also not the reason we're interested in digital. We don't want to get rid of the paperwork, we want to get rid of the repetition. So typically, if you take a patient's journey, when they get admitted to hospital, they turn up in the emergency department. And the first thing they do is they get asked a bunch of questions. Fantastic. Then we set out what they do, and that gets wrote down. And then they get into the emergency department because they need treatment. So a doctor comes along and asks them some questions. And a nurse comes along and asks them some questions. Pretty much the same questions have been asked three times now. The person needs to get admitted to the hospital. Okay, they get admitted to the ward. Surprise, surprise, a nurse comes along and asks them a bunch of questions. Exactly the same questions, but we have the paperwork to fill out. We have to ask them all over again. And then the doctor comes along and does the clerking, asking the same questions yet again. Reality, we should be taking those first questions and building on that knowledge. We don't need to find out on day one, right, okay, fantastic, you know, you live in a bungalow. You know, we do need to dig deeper when you find out and look at that. Actually, they've had a conversion, they've got a staircase and they can't get upstairs. But those are what we can dig into deeper. And the annoying thing is, once we've done all those questions, the physios come along and the OTs come along and they ask the same questions again. So what we're interested in is actually reducing down that repetition. And that's where EPRs and electronic systems really do fall into their front. Because once you start collecting that data, you know, it's so much better to go up to the patient. Oh, Mrs. Jones, I see you've been admitted for such and such. And, right, so you fell down the stairs in your bungalow. Okay, but isn't it much better to actually go up to the patient with the information really in your hand? The other thing we're really interested in as well is making things safer and better for our patients. The number one thing that really, really hurts nurses is when you see a patient in pain on the ward. Typically, the reason that a patient is in pain on the ward is the drug charts in pharmacy. Now, if you have an electronic system, The drug chart's never in pharmacy, so you can give the medications as prescribed. Simple things make life easier. You know, patients get stuck in hospital waiting for TTOs. Well, if the electronic systems are designed correctly, before the discharge is done, the pharmacist's already got the TTOs ready. God. I don't know who wrote these slides, but it seems to be an awful lot of me.
Who knows, really?
So, I had to steal a slide from Roy Lilly, because Roy is largely the reason why I was here, because he was going to do a presentation and then bring in the digital side, and then he didn't come and stitched us up and left us to talk about nursing. But this was just really to reiterate the point of, it's not just nurses alone. We need a whole MDT approach. We've all got different viewpoints. We all got different reasons for what we need to get. But nurses sort of interweave their way into everything. We speak to the doctors. We speak to the physios. You know, we spend the time with the patients.
This is a little bit more about the CNIO priorities. So this is the national CNIO priorities and the things that we're currently working on at the minute. So those of you that are vaguely digital in the NHS will be very aware of the What Good Looks Like framework. And we've done a lot of work about looking at our What Good Looks Like framework for nursing is. There's the Phillips Eyes Review, which is looking at digital nursing and maternity. And we're working towards some documentation standards. So to echo really what, I nearly called you Chris, that's terrible, isn't it? What Matt said around that, really reducing the documentation burden, but not just reducing the documentation burden, but again, echoing what Matt said, giving your patient confidence. If I say, Karina, so what's your partner's name? Or when were you last in hospital? And then Matt asks, and then somebody else asks, it chips away at that patient's confidence in your care. So there's the sort of things that we're looking at, and I think as nurses we're really bad at research, we're really bad at saying, actually I've done this really good thing and I'd like to tell you about it. And I'm not quite sure how we overcome that hurdle, but just recognising if you've done something good, even if you think it's a bit rubbish, you might as well have a shout about it. Some of the work that I'm doing in the region, so I'm really lucky that I think Debbie Guy from Nerve Centre is a little bit scared of me, so I'm sure she's not. I've known Debbie for a lot of years, maybe 20 plus years, and my acute trust has Nerve Centre as their EPR. My near neighbour, Nottingham University Hospitals, also have Nerve Centre as their EPR. And Leicester hospitals also have Nerve Centre. So what we're doing is we're trying to work smarter. And Nerve Centre have been generous enough to give us the doll's house. Well, I say give, obviously. We've bought it. And give us the furniture, but actually allow us to design that furniture as a collaborative. So at the minute, we're working together on some risk assessments for paediatrics. So if I do it at Sherwood, we're trusting across the region that that is the right thing. So we're working together that one assessment for our patients, whether they're at Leicester, Nottingham, Sherwood, which then, if we're thinking about the ICS, Sherwood and Nottingham are acute providers. If I'm giving the ICS exactly the same information and audit and data at the back end from those assessments, we can really compare trusts, can't we? Because we're comparing the same things. Really, you can tell I'm really excited about this. And I'm excited about this because, shamefully, I have a background in PMO. So I used to spend a long time trying to save millions of pounds. And this is how we're going to make those savings, grow things, do things smarter. I think this working together, particularly when you recognise that I can't get a digital project manager, and I certainly can't get one at a band 7, but if I shared that project manager across the system, paid them a little bit more, we're going to have recruitment's going to be a lot easier. And it's better value. just really a little bit about digital network. And, oh, this is your slide. I'm going to do it, though, because I feel like a bit sad. So there's quite a lot of digital nursing networks. So if you sat here thinking, I wonder what that Madden can do for me, or I wonder how I can get into some of this digital nursing pool. We are really under the umbrella of Dr. Natasha Phillips, who obviously works for Ruth May's office, and we have regional digital leads such as myself, and every region has a regional CNIO, and every region has a CNIO regional network. We also have a national shared decision-making council, and we have regional shared decision councils, and they're really great because they really help us understand from a student nurse up what that lived experience is, what improvements that people working at that front line of care can say. Do you know what? If you did this, if we just changed this, or we just twiddled with this, or bought this product, then this would have the real influence on patient care. And I think that's really important for me because I lose sight. I'm all big picture, so I really appreciate those people that are still frontline facing to inform me. I also have a son who's a student nurse who pretty much tells me how it is. I'll let you talk about the other two because they're your babies, aren't they?
Okay, so and there are also a couple of other bits and pieces. So the Digital Health CNIO Advisory Panel, which is all full of clever people that talk all clever stuff. And basically, yeah, I'm on there, but I'm not one of the clever people.
To be
people.
Fair, it's just Matt and me.
But they're there predominantly just to add that challenge into the wider picture. And we've also got the Digital Discussion Group, which is there for digital nurses, AHP and doctors to talk and share things. Because the one thing you need to take from this is, if you're doing a digital project with digital nurses, we talk, we share. So there is nowhere in the country we don't reach out to. We work together. So if a rep comes in and gives us a hard time in Nottingham, over in Worcester, we'll know about it. So be nice to us, we share.
I think that has its bonuses as well, doesn't it? So if we found something really good, so I can't shout enough about the conversions work I'm doing. And I know that we're looking at procuring a product at Sherwood, and I've reached out to a colleague and said, oh, what do you think? So it really gives us that honest opinion. And then what they tend to do is, oh, here's a quick reference guide. Oh, actually, you could have this and you could have that. So I'm not duplicating any work at all.
It really does cut down some of the waste time and the work, particularly clinical safety cases and things like this. We work through it. Now, there were a couple of questions coming out from the forums. We ummed and ahed about putting them out to the audience, see what you think of them. So, you know, as clinicians, we work very collaborative. You know, we've always doing falls collaboratives and things like this to work nationally. But why aren't our digital industry partners working collaboratively with us? We're finding some pockets are, but generally, These aren't my questions, by the way. They came from the forum. I'm completely innocent. You know, how do we bring what other clinical areas across the country have developed into our clinical areas from a digital project point of view? How do we share more digitally? And this one's wordy. So why is the NHS paying twice for the same work, which seems to be a common theme across a lot of areas? So if I work with my digital team to work with an EPR provider, we spend a lot of time developing a product that works for our hospital. And you know, the EPR company accepts it, it becomes part of their blueprint. They then go down the road with that blueprint and sell it to the next hospital. And then they spend a lot of time developing more stuff around it, and it becomes part of their blueprint. We're the ones doing, this is the NHS doing the work. Yet the NHS is the one that's broke. Maybe we're getting something quietly wrong. And again, you know, we can bring into the subject of data. So it's NHS data that we're that's being used to help build EPRs and medical data projects. And then they go off and sell that data elsewhere, but it's NHS data. The other companies don't work without the NHS data. So should we be exploring actually It's our data, so let's rent it to you, let's sell it to you, so you can build your EPR, so you can build your digital programs. I like to ask the questions. So, a couple of resources just to think about from a sharing point of view. One of which, because Roy Lilly and Terry were the ones that stitched me up to come and talk about this one, we have to blame them entirely, but the Academy of Fab NHS stuff is a collaborative that was put together about 4 or 5 years ago now. It's a very simple web page. It's basically, it's all about sharing QI. It works on the principle of if hospital A does stuff, they chuck it on there, anybody's free to have a look at it. You know, I mean, how many times can we all work at different hospitals, all do stuff on reducing pressure ulcers, and we all do the same things and lots of work about it. So it's all on there to share, to find out. But there is a growing number of digital innovations being put on there that are free to share, to learn. You know, and there's not always the perfect story. There's an awful lot on there. We tried this and it went wrong. Don't do this. Or do it differently. And it's great. I've got members of the digital discussion group in the audience, but this is a group we put together for nurses and AHPs sharing. So it's there as a big warm hug. It's a support network and it's somewhere to actually go and talk crap, because at times you need somebody professional you can actually go and talk about the stuff that you can't talk to your colleagues about because they don't understand. And leading on, and thankfully it's a closing thought, so we are getting close to an end. As digital professionals, we have moved more and more into remote working. From a clinical point of view, we train as groups. We work in clusters on wards, we work in groups, we work specialities. You get into the digital world and all of a sudden you're sat at home 4 or 5 days a week and your only connection is a Teams meeting. Just think about digital when very close to a change stop over Christmas where we don't do much. Those Teams meetings get reduced. Your colleagues have got nobody to talk to. They may not have a family, they may have other things going on at home, and you're their only contact. So digital can be incredibly lonely for people who spent 30 years working in teams. And it's a mindset change, and we're not used to it yet. So reach out, have a cup of tea with a friend online. It may make a difference.
Thank you. So I'm sure you've all got millions of questions to ask us, and if not, I bet you can sneak out and get a brew before the next session. So over to you, and don't feel pressurised to ask me anything too much. Oh, go for it.
Thank you very much. Yep. Hi, good morning. My name is Sue. I'm actually one of the senior ITU nurses in the Royal Navy, so military nurse. And something that I've definitely observed over the years is I bounce around trusts a lot because of the work that I do, and I've currently just come up to London to do a non-clinical job, but I need to keep my clinical hours, so I've had to sign on to yet another trust, and I've gone through yet another induction, which was, I have to say, the most painful one I've done yet. It took months. And what I do not understand is why we still do localized induction trusts, where my basic life support, which is a national thing, I still have to redo every time I move trust. Now, I know it's been looked at before, it's been looked at in pockets, but we're in 2022, and I still can't transfer my standard competencies when I move around from one trust to another. And I certainly think it's something that this information sharing needs to get together and go, this is the one single point of truth where you can take your competency passport from one place to another and not have to go through what can be quite long-winded and painful. And also it's man hour, or person hours, I beg your pardon, and it's booking rooms and all the training that we know we do. So it's just a point I know we're looking at from a military innovation, because we move a lot, we deploy a lot, we need the competencies, but how are we still going through that every single time?
Yeah, it's crackers. So I go back to my son. He learned how to do basic life support on a computer with two keys. I found that amazing. So there is some work underway. I don't know if we've got anybody here from Blackpool, but they're leading some really good work on a digital staff passport. I think they've got it to a point that they're going to start and spread and share that. And that is very much, like you say, if I can do basic life support in Wolverhampton, I can do it in Medway. it's no different. So there are some core competencies, so there is work going on. It's just one of those, you know, everybody wants to do it. It's just quite difficult, isn't it? And Blackpool have absolutely grasped the nettle and are running with that. So hopefully we'll start to see some of that coming out soon, and I will think of you.
Well, I'm going to sneak an extra one in. I've applied to the Florence Nightingale Foundation, and my project that I'm looking at is intelligent access for CD cupboards, because I also think it's mind-boggling that we're in 2022 with all this fantastic technology, but it's still two old-fashioned Yale keys trying to find your friend, go and get sign out from the book. Why are we still doing that with the technology that's available? So it's marrying the two together.
You're going to smash Florence with that. My name is really unusual. My email is my name at nhs.net. We do fingerprint, so you know it might be worth not for CD cupboards, because God forbid we shouldn't have a set of keys that we take home at least three times in our career. But yeah, you'll really enjoy that. I agree. It's just crazy, isn't it? We can open our phone with our faces. Why can't we open a CD cupboard?
And I've just been lucky to be on a tour around America to Texas and Alabama. And they do actually have a digital solution. It is possible. It's very, very expensive, but man hours, time over, you know, it takes an awful lot of time to chase CD keys, especially when you take them home.
Are there any suppliers in the room or no? Cool. It was just, I was wondering if you've got a thought about how you get clinical engagement in projects, or if you know the CNIO role might be interesting to you, or you already have your networks.
Yeah, no, I was actually going to ask the question. So my name's Tria Whisker. I'm director of Minuteful for Wound Services. So we have a digital wound management solution from Healthy.io, the company. And I was going to ask about how your role helps to inform what priorities you have as an organisation to digitally transform, because obviously wound care is a huge amount of activity that happens certainly in the community, but obviously that transfer of the patient through the settings into primary care and into the acute, we're trying to really help to solve that problem. So I'm really interested to know how you help to inform what you prioritise to invest in as a digital transformation project, and then from our perspective, how we like to work with we like to work in partnership with our NHS partners and really involve all layers within the organisation, very much like Roy Lilly's chart there, actually, to understand what each layer of the organisation needs so that we can meet those needs. So whether it's just a high-level dashboard for an exec who just wants to see what impact that solution's making, for example, right through to what the experience of the patient is and how we can capture that within our digital solution. So very much like to have every role within an organisation as part of what we do as we kind of build what our solution can deliver.
Do you want me to answer for Sherwood and you can answer for Worcester? I can talk for my acute trust. So we have quite robust governance. So we have a digital strategy that is adhered to with a rod of iron. And lots of things magically fit into that. But we consider it as a team. So we have a CIO, CDIO, CNIO, CCIO. And clinicians will bring a project to us and say, I'm thinking about Steph, who's my tissue viability nurse. I really want to do this. And we consider then in the round patient benefit, priorities, resource, and then try and schedule that in. And obviously a massive factor is money. And as I'm sure we're all sat here now, knowing that frontline digitization, there's no great big pot of money arriving, is there? I've been waiting for a big suitcase of millions of pounds to land at my doorstep, but looks like they've stripped it away a little bit. So yeah, we do have quite a robust method, and I think we're getting a much better at going out to market rather than people come in and saying, I think it's Isla. I know that isn't your product. I want this. What they're saying is, I want this solution, and can we go out and look at that and start to procure, which then, like you say, we can look at more in the round. So I really like what you're saying. So as a CNIO, I might be completely obsessed by what the patient's safety is and the outcomes, but my CDIO might be just wants to know what he can get out the back door data-wise. Matt, did you want to add?
No, I mean, we've had to take a bit more pragmatic approach to our procurement at the moment. Basically, we need an EPR. We're in the process of implementing one. We spent our money. There isn't an awful lot left in the kitty, so we're looking at what works with the EPR. You know, single sign-on, digital dictation. Everything else is out the window for the next couple of years. As much as there's a huge amount of evolution going on and there's stuff that we want, it's the NHS kitty, there isn't any. So again, we are looking at, things do come up, but then we have to go out for national funding to see if they can support things, you know. And it's trying to get that balance of, because we'll get a lot of suppliers who give us something for 2 years at a trial, and then they run away and leave us the bill.
Yeah. Hi there. My name's Debbie. I work for Life Sciences Hub Wales, who've actually done quite a lot of the supported health EIO. So one of my colleagues was involved. I just really wanted to comment on what you said about how, you know, the engagement piece that's really difficult. So I started life as a nurse, so thank you, because I remember that's who I am through and through. But also I've worked in big pharma and digital health startups before joining Life Science Hub, which is kind of the Welsh equivalent of the AHSNs. And I think from my experience, just across my career really, I think one of the biggest issues around engagement is, it really has always been, people are so busy at the front line. So, you know, how do you fit it into the everyday work, which is even more of a challenge now, I think, than it has been. And I'm still in touch with colleagues who are just, you know, they've got these ideas, they just don't know how to bring them into reality. And I think also on the ground, you've got frontline staff who don't really know where to go when they've got an innovation. They don't know about R&D departments. They don't think that anyone's there to support them when actually they are. So I think there's a visibility piece around innovation departments as well. There's a lot that I could say about it over the years, but you know, I think visibility is one thing, and knowing that actually you can do things and it doesn't always have to cost a fortune. And I think certainly in our role now, there's collaboration between industry and the NHS. I think there's still a long way to go to develop that trusting relationship, but I think it is changing. I think it is changing a lot. So, you know, you've got to trust each other. So.
No, I mean, engagement is one of our biggest issues at the moment. You know, I'm trying to roll out an EPR. Apparently it's winter and there's some bug that's been floating around causing chaos for the last couple of years, and the ward staff are a bit busy. So trying to actually get that core level engagement for people who desperately, desperately want the engagement, but they haven't got the time to even think. They're just there to get through the shift and maybe get off with an hour or two of it finishing to then come back and do it again. So it is a constant plod. I mean, We try everything. We've got, you know, you can do the emails and the newsletters, but nobody's going to read that. We do pop-up events. I do wandering the wards. We've got a shared decisions council for the ward, for the wards, for people to pop in and just randomly put stuff in there. And I, you know, my biggest help is I've got a team of clinical change analysts. So they spend a lot of time out in the clinical areas. I've recruited them from the wards, so they're from ED theatres. So they know their colleagues, they know their friends, and several of them are doing one day a week in the clinical areas. So it's great because they're working for me when they're in the clinical area. They just don't realise that bit yet.
Yeah, I think there's something that we're missing as well. So we are not equipping our student learners to work in a digitally enabled hospital environment. And that fundamentally is wrong. And when I've spoken, I'm going to do some university bashing now. When I've spoken to universities and said to them, you know, can I come and talk to your students? What are you teaching them? Oh, well, you know, I can't teach them 7 different EPRs. I'm not asked. I bet you don't know. I bet you can muddle your way around 7 EPRs because you're highly skilled. What I'm asking is to ensure that your student learners have that appetite, know that they're going to work in that digitally driven environment. These are really clever people. Most nurses now coming out with a master's. And they're coming out with a master's for a reason, because they're critical thinkers. And I think it's those people that we really need to grow and nurture to say, actually, we could do this better. I think it's digital. Ooh. That woman that wears that navy uniform that comes and answers buzzers and feeds people now and again because she misses nursing, let's speak to her. And I think that is the real power of the Shared Decision Making Council. But we are young, don't we, as nurses? And I had a very long conversation about this yesterday. We need to get that leadership right at the ward and department level as well to allow these people to flourish and to have that innovation and to have the hour off, because that hour off might save 7 or 8 hours. So yeah, I think I think definitely the Shared Decision Making Council for me has been a really great thing, and I think this role allows me to do a bit of, my friends call it dollying. I think that's a bit cruel, but a bit of going out there, understanding what's happening, talking to student nurses, all of that. I feel quite privileged to be able to do that.
Hi, my name's Liz Raub. I just wanted to go back to the point my colleague made here. I have what they call a portfolio career, and I work for a number of different organisations now. And it's actually more complex than just having to do the same training. I would like to share with this universe that I have now done safeguarding level 3 for adults and children 4 times in the last 12 months. Because it's not simply about the same learning, which is all on e-learning for health, but it's about individuals, organizations' inability to demonstrate compliance with that training for their people who are connected with them to regulators. So it's a much bigger issue at national level than Blackpool doing it in the nicest possible way. I mean, I'd like 20 quid for every time someone's told me over the last 20 years someone's getting this cracked for a passport. And still no one has. But we need to really tackle the national systems that say each individual organisation needs to be able to demonstrate the compliance of people who connect with them. And that's the issue.
I have no words to make that better. Who knew?
All right, any final questions before we finish and move on to our next panel?
Hello, thank you. So I want to touch back on the point where you mentioned about duplicate records and nursing and things. So I mean, I'm going to speak based on my personal experience, right? But sometimes, with the help of EPR, when you have everything through the lines where you carry information through, when it reached to a specialist or when it reached to a doctor, they would build on, for example, build on existing information, but they would still basically be asking similar questions to dive deeper into their own, you know, purpose of why they are there, why they're facing the patient. So do you think, would it be a culture thing, or is it actually a problem that the EPR can solve, or is it something that's much deeper than that?
I think it's how you approach things from a clinical point of view. It's nice going up to the person and actually having that information in hand so you can build on it and actually go up to Mrs. Jones, I understand she had a fall, then a doctor going up to the patient and go, so, you're Mrs. Jones, right. It helps and guides, and it does reassure that patient that actually you do have a slight clue of what's going on. You know, if I was going into the medical profession to see a person for the first time, I would ask a lot of the questions again for verification that actually I have got the right Mrs. Jones who fell while she was walking down the stairs in the bungalow, because there might have been another Mrs. Jones who burnt her hand using the kettle. But it's how you approach those questions and having that knowledge rather than, you know, the piece of paper that nobody actually read has been wrote down 6 times to start those conversations. You'll find we do use that as the basis, that confirmation, and then build on it. It's how you use it clinically as well.
I think with anything digital, and I use this a lot, when I was a proper nurse, when I did proper nursing, there was a lot of, that patient doesn't look very well. The robs are all right, but there's something not right. And I think I'm looking at nurses in the room that I, you know, you get that feeling, you know something's right. Nothing will ever take that away. And neither should it. And I think it's having the digital tools to support that decision making. Very much like you. I think, you know, when we talk about not duplicating documentation, I think it's absolutely all right. If you've written it down, I should trust you. I think that's what you're saying. If you're an OT, you've got the same skills of assessing a patient, probably a little bit more than I have, to be fair. So I should be able to trust you. And then the richness and the conversation and the assessment comes from your professional standpoint. So you're not taking the demographics or you're not taking the history. What you're doing is then saying, so tell me, Mrs. Jones, how big are your stairs? How often have you been falling? Is it, you know, is there a pattern on that? So you're building into that without then having to go back into that, what happened, et cetera, et cetera. And I think what I missed out is during COVID, I got knocked off my bike by a kid. There's a reason that I'm not very fond of children. And I broke my shoulder. And so I ended up working in vaccine centres because I could vaccinate one-handed. And what really stuck out for me is patients think that we know when we open NIMS, PIMS, I can't remember what it is now, that we know all about them. And that absolutely should be what our patients should have, isn't it? That whether I'm in a vaccine centre or a hospital or a GP surgery or a pharmacist, what the patient thinks is happening is actually what's happening.
Amazing, thank you. Can I have a big hand for our panellists for sharing that insight into the really important roles that CNOs are doing across the healthcare system? Thank you so much. Thank you.